Hi, Garima. Thank you so much for speaking with the CSR Journal. First, I'd like to know what kind of activities is GSK involved in?
So GSK CSR is concentrated in the space of healthcare. Okay. We have a long-term partnership with the World Health Organization, where we are partnering India to eliminate lymphatic filariasis. As you would know, lymphatic filariasis or elephant foot, elephantitis, or even commonly known as haathi pair, is a neglected tropical disease, and it is very widespread in India. Actually, if you look at it, 600 million people are at risk of contracting this disease. And since it doesn't have a cure, prevention becomes even more important. So we've committed our funds till 2020, till such time that it's eliminated as a public health problem.
Okay.
We're also looking at the space of newborn care and newborn health. As you would be aware, in the Millennium Development Goals, we were not able to achieve our maternal and under 5 mortality targets, primarily because we lost a lot of newborns.
Okay.
So that's the rationale why we're working in the high burden districts in Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh for the entire continuum of care. So it's very current, it's as per the India Newborn Action Plan. And we're looking at both facility and community-based models.
Most corporates tend to initiate their CSR activities in and around the space near their offices, in their vicinity, so they can monitor it eventually. The problem we hear is we do not reach out on a nationwide basis, say for example the areas in Northeast or somewhere down in the Southwest. What do you think needs to change over there? How can we change that?
So it's in an idea of a sphere of influence, and I think it's also very project driven. If you look at our lymphatic filariasis project, now this is not going to be restricted in any particular location where your presence is, right?
Okay.
It'll be where the need is. Similarly, even for newborn survival, if you look at it, the states of Rajasthan and Madhya Pradesh, we don't have a presence either in terms of even a sales office.
Okay.
But statistics show that Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, UP and Bihar, these four states actually account for 50% of newborn deaths.
Okay.
So if these are the states that require an intervention, so we are present in two of these four states.
Okay.
But you're right, if you look at the CSR spend trend, Northeast has received very less of it. But the idea is also if you are tying CSR, if you're making it relevant to your internal stakeholders, if you're engaging your employees through volunteering, it just, I think it's about ease.
Okay.
But again, if there is a public health issue or a issue that you've taken up which requires a widespread presence, then the purpose becomes larger than the area of operation.
Fair enough. So how do you think we can correctly use the funds which have come into the CSR pool after the mandate for the nation's betterment, you know, streamline those funds correctly?
Sure. So I think the expectation from corporates was really to create models that can be replicable and that are scalable.
Okay.
Because that's the strength of corporates. Project management is a strength that corporates bring in. And in the process, all the partners and stakeholders that are involved would also benefit.
Correct.
I think the basic premise and one thing we have to be very clear about is that it's not expected to shift the needle drastically in terms of the percentage of spends that the government does for social change and social infrastructure. CSR funds, even if all the corporates were meeting their obligation, wouldn't be more than 1% of the total spends.
Okay.
With that perspective, the idea is to create best practices, have sharing, right? And make sure that all the CSR partners and all the stakeholders that you are looking at are benefiting from the project, whether in terms of a knowledge gain or in terms of a project impact.
So when you speak of all stakeholders, that is the individuals, the government, the corporates, the NGOs who are the main implementing partners, how do you think we can bring individual social responsibility, you know, the common man social responsibility to the forefront? Because they usually tend to get carried away thinking CSR, corporate social responsibility, is some kind of jargon. So how do we tell those individuals that, you know, you need to play your part and this is something you're doing in your daily life too?
Sure. So I think volunteering is a great key for it. Whether it's one day volunteering, whether it's full time, 3 to 6 months, or even some corporates are giving time off for a year or two, it does promote a social connect.
Okay.
Having said that, I think it's also a definition of a corporate value.
Okay.
So for example, at GSK, we are very high on respect for people, right? Integrity. These are our core values, transparency. And those are reflecting even in the behaviors, even on our corporate behavior.
So we have seen how after the mandate, initially it was philanthropy in India, and we had hereditary philanthropy where the people usually left it for their sons and grandsons. But now the movement has started to be outside the family, and of course as the mandate. So how do you see that trend changing after being there in the industry for so long? And more importantly, where do you see it going in the next 5 to 10 years?
Sure. So you're right, it did start with philanthropy, and I don't think that's going anywhere. If you look at the family businesses, or even if you look at individuals, philanthropy is, I think, and giving is a part of our culture.
Correct.
But in terms of CSR, it has evolved into a more strategic space.
Correct.
You're looking at actually quantifiable outcomes. You are defining these expected outcomes at the beginning of the project.
Mm.
And along with your CSR partner, then you're looking at what milestones and when.
Okay.
Right? So I think in that space, it has definitely shifted.
Mm.
In the next 5 to 6 years, I look at it evolving further. You know, the matrix of monitoring and evaluation becoming simplified. You being able to collect voices from the field using technology, which we've already started kind of experimenting with. And so because every time you have a partner, you're creating a layer between yourself and the community.
Correct.
So it's important to make sure that you are hearing directly from the community as well.
Okay.
Right? So what kind of strategies are you looking at for obtaining that voice is where that shift and change is going to be. And technology will play an important role for that.
Okay. You spoke about development goals. So India is committed to them by 2030 to complete certain. Healthcare is also one of them. How far do you see the nation kind of progressing towards it, and how much are we actually in line and in time to achieve it?
So if you look at the latest UN reports, we're already doing something better in nutrition.
Okay.
Right? So I definitely see that the goal 3 is a reality.
Hmm.
It's not something which is very far off.
Hmm.
We're working towards it. India Newborn Action Plan, targets for elimination of Kala-Azar, lymphatic filariasis, all these are absolutely in line with the steps and milestones that will be required to achieve it in 2030 eventually. So I think we are absolutely on track.
Okay. Tell me a little more about the pharmaceutical industry and the kind of activities that they take up, you know. I don't mean in terms of a competition with the other sectors, but how and where do you see them progressing in terms of the social good that needs to come in?
Sure. So actually, if you look at the pharma industry CSR spends, they're very much in line with the other industries where we've about achieved just a little more than 50% compliance for the obligation. But, and you're right, again, investment in technology incubators has received very less
little
funding.
Yes.
So that's also true for the pharma industry.
Okay.
But frankly, we won't be surprised with it because our core competence is healthcare.
Okay.
That is something that we understand and we're working towards. And every company is actually looking towards how they can promote access, right? Whether it's your price volume strategy, whether it's your areas of development and R&D. So you're looking at promoting access.
Okay.
So you're right. We understand health issues which are there in urban areas or even rural areas, and we have to look at the way how we can promote preventive healthcare particularly, and also provide access in terms of curative healthcare through mobile medical vans, through medical camps that a lot of pharma companies are doing.
Okay.
GSK particularly is taking up, like I said, a public health issue and looking at tackling it. Going
okay.
forward, we will also look at antibiotic resistance. We've already started looking at it. So that is something that we are...
Okay. You personally feel very involved with all the activities that GSK does. How do you measure the impact of it? Because most companies try to look at a return on investment or where they're going, where they need to change, where the shift needs to happen. So what is it that you all consider and, you know, make decisions in the future?
So we have indicators before we get into a project.
Okay.
And these indicators are actually agreed upon with our implementing partners, whom we call CSR partners. And these are quantifiable as well as qualitative,
okay.
right? But, and we keep track in terms of monitoring and evaluation. I told you that we are trying to get in a technology, the P3 platform, to actually monitor and assess the impact and get voices directly from the field as well.
Hmm.
And we play back quantifiable as well as qualitative data and look at where are the spaces that we can improve.
Okay.
Also our GSK India management team, which are basically heads of our departments, are also sponsors for a particular project.
Okay.
So we are able to bring in an outside in perspective when they go to the field and they kind of assess the project and look at where can we add value. Also in terms, I think, because you're not interacting only with one organization but multiple partners, you're able to pick out what are the best practices and then bring that to the table. I think that's our key role really as catalysts and facilitators. So we are able to promote that best practice sharing.
Okay.
So that's an added value.
Do you all also involve the employees in the activities that you all do, or give them a day off and, you know, say that it's not a, it will be a paid leave, so go and volunteer and do something? Do you all, is that how you'll involve employees too?
Sure. So GSK actually has a very robust volunteering program.
Okay.
We have something called the Pulse Partnership, which is a full-time 3 to 6 months paid volunteering.
Okay.
So it's skills-based.
Okay.
We identify projects with organizations, not only in India but also abroad. And then we look at and we map skills of the employees who are selected as Pulse volunteers to the project.
Okay.
There are, again, like I said, definite outcomes that the Pulse volunteer is expected to achieve, which are agreed upon with the NGO. And there is an evaluation at the end of it.
Okay.
And your so your pay is protected. Your performance incentives is linked to your performance even at the Pulse.
So there's extensive kind of engagement that is there on your part. What is the kind of feedback that comes in? And also being a decision-making person, what are the kind of loopholes that you see in this domain and sphere, you know, from what's happening or probably that's not even happening?
In terms of feedback, it's obviously extremely enlightening to be there, right? It's an instant gratification. Like teaching kids is something that you'll get an instant reaction. Either they will sleep or they'll be engaged. So gratification is also instant, right?
Correct.
So I think it's every time we do these surveys, the feedback surveys, we hit the roof in terms of how engaged people were or what their feedback was.
Okay.
In terms of improvements, I believe scalability is something that we need to crack on.
All right.
Because right now we're looking at about 10% of our employees volunteering. And if we genuinely look at it, we see that it adds value even to an individual.
Okay.
Specifically those who go for Pulse volunteering.
Okay.
Once they've come back, we've kind of mapped their growth trends. And we see that, you know, project management, leadership, working in an ambiguous environment, working under resource constraints, end-to-end management. These are some things that they definitely pick up.
Okay.
You know, because it's a different sector. They don't have dedicated departments of procurement and IT. So you're looking at a project end-to-end. So it gives them that bandwidth. And GSK sees value in that.
Okay.
So if you are convinced that there is a value, then this whole issue of how do we scale it up,
okay,
I think that will be something that I would be working on.
Okay. So recently, you all funded a certain amount of monetary figure to Arman, the NGO. I'd like to know, even previously, what are the parameters you all have considered before you all have decided to join hands with someone?
Sure. Arman was not a CSR spend.
Okay.
Arman was in award money.
All
right. So Arman, for their Mitra program, which is a free voice call service, which is customized, won an innovation award, which was to the tune of $115,000, which is approximately 74 lakhs. So that's an award, but it's over and above CSR. It's not a part of CSR.
Okay.
To answer the second part of the question as to what are the considerations, I think it has to be aligned to our strategy. So we have something called a CSR working group, which are, you know, some members from the management team are a part of that. And we sit together along with our CSR committee, which is the board representation. And we look at what strategy, what is our CSR strategy, which are the areas we really want to make a difference. And then look at what are the areas that we can make a difference. Okay? And based on that strategy, then we go around looking for a CSR partner, which is aligned. And we co-create projects.
Okay.
So if you look at our newborn survival project, it was completely co-created.
Okay.
Right, as to what component would be facility-based, where would the concentration be, whether it's on home-based newborn care, whether it's on improvement of facility, which are the government facilities that we'll be working on. So you have a broad idea of where your CSR is headed.
Okay.
And then the idea is to get like-minded partners who have the same purpose and who have the same commitment. There is a value alignment and we co-create projects.
Okay. We initially had the give and take feeling when we used to kind of donate or call it philanthropy or charity for that matter. But now there's a concept of sharing value. You know, what's mine can also be given to you. We don't have that in India as of now, on implemented on a very large scale. How do you think that can change and, you know, improve in the industry and the social approach mainly?
Sure. So I think concept of shared value is very much there.
Okay.
Even if you're not calling that exactly,
okay,
right? Like every time you implement a CSR project, not only the community benefits, you have indirect benefits as well.
Okay. Right?
So is it quantified that what is the amount that you are benefiting? Yes, you have tools like SROI that you talked about, where you are now able to actually put a number to it as well. So this shared concept, shared value concept is definitely there.
Yeah.
A lot of social businesses are right now based on that concept. Right. A lot of startups are looking at this concept. So it's certainly picking up. And I think it's an interesting take. The idea is, you know, it has a higher acceptance, even internally, when you look at it this way. But in terms of, you know, if you look at it through branding, before the mandate, CSR was a differentiator.
Correct.
After the mandate, you're not going branding crazy because it's not a differentiator. Right, you'll be more focused on what the impact is and you'll be more focused on what's the difference you've made. And that will be your differentiator.
Could you tell me very briefly what is CSR to you?
My purpose.
Okay.
Yes, so I think it's about spreading smiles and making sure that these smiles are genuine.
Okay.
So CSR is just a way of being. Corporates are adopting it not out of mandate. I think everybody individually as well as collectively wants to do good.
Okay.
And that's how, like I said, giving is something that is ingrained in us, right?
Okay.
And whether you look at family businesses, whether you look at strict compliance frameworks that multinationals bring in, everybody is here to do good, right?
Okay.
So it's about committing to it and being serious about that doing good.
It's been very insightful talking to you. Thank you so much for your time, Garima. Thank you.
It's been wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you.